يا رب لك الحمد حتى ترضى ولك الحمد إلى ما رضيت ولك الحمد بعد الرضا ولك الحمد أبدا 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 فالحمد لله الذي لم يتخذ ولدا ولم يكن له شريك في الملك ولم يكن له ولي من الذل وكبره تكبيرا الحمد لله الذي أنزل على عبده الكتاب ولم يجعل له عوجا والحمد لله الذي نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونؤمن به ونتوكل عليه ونعوذ به من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له ونشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له ونشهد أن محمدا عبد الله ورسوله أرسله الله تعالى بالهدى ودين الحق ليظهره على الدين كله وكفى بالله شهيدا فصلى الله عليه وسلم تسليما كثيرا كثيرا ثم أما بعد فإن أصدق الحديث كتاب الله وخير الهدي هدي محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم وإن شر الأمور محدثاتها وإن كل محدثة بدعة وكل بدعة ضلالة وكل ضلالة في النار يقول سبحانه وتعالى في كتابه الكريم بعد نقول أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم والشعراء يتبعهم الغاوون ألم تر أنهم في كل واد يهيمون وأنهم يقولون ما لا يفعلون إلا الذين آمنوا وعملوا الصالحات وذكروا الله كثيرا وانتصروا من بعد ما ظلموا وسيعلم الذين ظلموا أي منقلب ينقلبون رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقه قولي واللهم ثبتنا عند الموت بلا إله إلا الله واللهم اجعلنا من الذين آمنوا وعملوا الصالحات وتواصوا بالحق وتواصوا بالصبر آمين يا رب العالمين Inshallah, in today's khutbah, I'd like to share with you some brief reflections from the last ayat of Surat Ash-Shu'ara. Probably we won't get through all of the last ayat, but just some aspects of this that I think are very important for all Muslims to be aware of. It's one of the few instances in the Quran where Allah has a very comprehensive commentary on what you can call nowadays the entertainment industry. But before we talk about that, just some things about Surat Ash-Shu'ara itself. This is Surat Ash-Shu'ara, the 26th surah of the Quran. And it's beautiful for a number of reasons, and one of them is that it actually continuously repeats legacies of previous prophets, one after the other, after the other, after the other. Musa alayhi salam is mentioned in some more detail than others, but there are multiple prophets talked about one after the other. And what's really remarkable about them is that even those who memorize the surah, they'll notice that what the prophets said, what all of them said, is identical almost. So the words are actually repeated over and over and over again. For instance, a phrase like فَاتَّقُوا اللَّهَ وَأَطِيعُونَ you know, have taqwa of Allah and obey me, is repeated. Now these prophets are very far apart. You know, you have Nuh alayhi salam, you have Hud alayhi salam, and there are eons, centuries, but millennia of a difference in the times in which they came. And yet the Quran is quoting them with an identical language. It's quoting them with identical language, which is really remarkable. It's something to think about. And that's one of the testimonies that Islam has always been the same. Right? These people came to different generations, different societies, different cultures, you know, different regions, different eras, even different languages. But when Allah translates their message to us in the Quran, He uses exactly the same words. So they had complete consistency in their message from one to the next to the next to the next to the next. Incidentally, since the Christian faith is now being more highlighted as we approach Christmas season and all of that. On a side note, one of the things that we don't debate with Christians, and we shouldn't like necessarily go back and forth with them about Islam versus Christianity and all of that. But if they do ask you about your faith at work, and you know a Christian fellow, a friend of yours is asking you about Islam and why you believe what you believe and things like that. Look, one of the biggest things that you know gives us confidence in our faith is the consistency of Islam. In other words, we believe that Ibrahim alayhi salam, Musa alayhi salam, Isa alayhi salam, all of them preached the same message. Their God is one, their message is one, they preached the one and the same thing. And actually, if you look at the Christian faith, one of the most interesting things about them is they single Isa alayhi salam out. All across the different denominations, they single out Isa alayhi salam, they single out Jesus, and apparently his message is different from all the others, according to them even. Right, God is one. Never before is God ever, you know, speaking of a son of his that is going to be sacrificed for the sins of humanity. That message was not preached by Ibrahim alayhi salam, nor by Musa alayhi salam, nor by any other prophet, even in their own book. You know, like, and I asked a minister one time, you know, none of these prophets that you believe in talked about the coming of the Son of God. None of them ever talked about it. If it's such a big deal, it's the biggest thing that ever happened according to you. This is the one instance, this is one event, the birth of Christ, according to you, is the one instant now humanity has a hope of being saved. So this is the biggest thing in human history according to you. And yet none of the prophets that God sent before ever talked about it. I don't understand. How does that work? You go, well, no, they did talk about the Comforter. And I was like, how does the Comforter equal Son of God? If it's, they weren't clear if it's going to be the Son of God or not. I don't understand. Right? But we don't have that problem. Previous prophets, they spoke about one ilah. They spoke about obedience to Him. They spoke about leaving evil deeds. They spoke about the Akhirah. They warned nations that they will be destroyed if they disbelieved in prophets. And it's consistent. It's the same. And so it's very easy for someone who believes in previous prophets to accept Islam, because they see that immediate consistency and honoring. The other thing is, you know, in the age of marketing, it's like my product versus your product, right? But what does Islam do? The beautiful thing about Islam is, it's not my prophet versus your prophet. It's not Jesus versus Muhammad, ma'adallah. These are all, they're all one jama'ah. They're all one people, they're one ummah. And they are brethren to each other. And the covenant even Allah took from them is that they are, if another prophet comes among them, that they will confirm the previous one. That they'll keep on confirming one after the other. So they're actually part of one group. We're the ones who think of this as competition. There's no competition. And even when Allah mentions, تِلْكَ الرُّسُلُ فَضَّلْنَا بَعْضَهُمْ عَلَىٰ بَعْضٍ, that we took some messengers and we gave them preference or some favors over others, it actually is only for Allah to determine who stands where. You know, and Allah highlighted, for example, I gave something special to Dawud alayhi salam. And there's a difference for us to understand the difference between tafriq and tafdeel. لَا نُفَرِّقُ بَيْنَ أَحَدٍ مِّن رُسُلِهِ. We say that explicitly in the Quran. We don't distinguish, we don't make tafriq. What that means is we don't say one is a messenger, the other's not. One is good, the other's not that good. We never say that. That's tafriq. But Allah Himself did tafdeel, which means some were given some special favor, somebody else was given some other special favor. What was given to Musa alayhi salam is unique and different from what was given to Isa alayhi salam, etc., etc. They're all separate, they're all unique, right? And that's up to Allah Azza wa Jalla. Now coming back to this, one of the reasons I mentioned that, the consistency of the messages of all previous prophets, is that of course messengers are trying to attract an audience. They're trying to make sure that people hear this message. And in that sense, there's a connection, there's a parallel between what a prophet does and actually on the opposite end, what an entertainer does. Because an entertainer also wants to get an audience. And messengers are also desperate to make this message heard to their entire audience. But the entertainer, what he does to make sure that his audience keeps coming back, he has to come up with a new message, a new song. He can't sing the old song because they already heard it. They're like, give us something new. What is that? I'm not coming back to the same concert again. I've already heard that song. I'm not downloading this movie again. I already watched this one. When's the next movie? What's the next thing? So entertainers need to continuously come up with something new. That's part of the problem they have, right? Otherwise they become irrelevant. Like even the younger audience that's sitting here 2-3 years ago, what was the number one song that was platinum? Who cares and who remembers? Because they disappear into thin air in 2 weeks. And the only way these artists can stay relevant is they come up with something else. Contrast that with the message of messengers. The messengers, alayhi salatu wasalam, and like take the case of the ideal case of Nuh alayhi salam, he's with his people for a very, very long time. But he's not interested in changing his message to attract a new audience. He's not interested in maybe if I just kind of, you know, present something else for a change to lure them in with some other means or something. No, the message is the message. It is what it is. And it's not like he had a very involved, intricate message, alayhi salam, a very clear message, a straightforward message, which can be summarized like Surat Ash-Shu'ara does in like very few words. فَاتَّقُوا اللَّهَ وَأَطِيعُونَ is the summary of it. Have taqwa of Allah and follow me. That's all I'm asking. That's all there is to it. There's some very basic teachings that were given to the prophets, alayhi salatu wasalam. What we learn from that as da'is and as carriers of Islam is that we don't need to be worried about impressing people. We don't need to follow the way of entertainers. We don't need to worry about what they're going to think. We need to worry about what the message itself is. We have to stay genuine to the message itself. And we have to believe that the word Allah gave us, the Quran, and the profound teachings of His Messenger, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, they in and of themselves are compelling enough, powerful enough, captivating enough, that you don't need to do any extra work on the outside. If you can be genuine to the text itself, the revelation itself, then it's compelling enough to anybody who has an ounce of decency, they'll be attracted to it anyway. I mean, this is a message that, I shared this with you a few weeks ago or months ago when I came and gave a khutbah about Surat Al-Jinn. The jinns are just passing by, نَفَرُوا مِنَ الْجِنِّ. They just heard Quran, right? And that was enough for them to just pull over and be mesmerized and captivated. So now here, in these last ayat, Allah makes a comment about poets. So some brief things about poets before I, you know, the contrast with the Messenger alayhi salatu wasalam, and all messengers. The Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wasalam, he's given a concern not that the audience is watching you, but rather that Allah is watching you. So how beautifully Allah Azza wa Jalla says, "Alladhi yaraka hina taqum," towards the end of Surah Ash-Shu'ara. The one who sees you, meaning Allah, the one who sees you when you stand up. See, an entertainer, their only concern is, who's watching? My fans are watching. Their concern is the opinions of my fans. Are they going to give me a standing ovation at the end? Are they going to go buy my song or buy my album at the end? Are they going to give me an accolade or an award at the end or not? So they're concerned about the opinion of their audience. They're really concerned about that. Now, a messenger is also in a public position. A da'i is also in a public position. He's also got a message to deliver to an audience. But you know what? The only one he has to worry about is Allah is watching. He doesn't have to worry about what the people think. And as a matter of fact, most prophets, alayhi wasalam, they did not have a very cooperative audience. They did not have an audience that enjoyed listening to them. For the most part, the people that they had to speak to were people that were not interested in listening to begin with, and were extremely disrespectful and antagonistic towards the message also. What that teaches you and me is, we have to stop worrying about what the people might think, what the audience might think. We have to think more about what Allah is going to say, because He's watching us when we deliver this message, when we talk, right? The truth over all else. A lot of times when you speak to someone, unfortunately in some settings, you know, you're invited to an interfaith panel, or there's a group of people that are sitting together and they're talking about their faiths, and you're asked something about Islam. Does Islam really say that? Does it really say that? And you're thinking in your head, man, if I give the straight answer, they're going to be really offended. That's really politically incorrect. If I just say what Islam actually says. So you worry about your audience, and you end up saying something that isn't true to Allah's deen. This is what we're talking about here. That's the job of an entertainer, to overly concern himself or herself with the audience. Not the da'i, not the one who calls to Allah. They only have to worry about standing in front of Allah. That's it. That Allah is watching. I better say it, give it straight. I better give it like it is. I better tell it like it is. Now, at the same time as I say that, the balance of this is also, it's not just what we say, it's how we say it. So we don't just learn that the prophets were honest, alayhimu salatu wasalam, that they were straightforward, but they had a very profound, wise, delicate, you know, subtle, loving way of saying things. They had a sensitive way of communicating. The message was always the same, but the style with which they gave it was different. Different people needed different styles of receiving the message. So that requires a lot of intelligence on the part of a da'i to understand who they're talking to and what level are they going to talk to them about. How are they going to prioritize what they're going to say? If I was talking to children, I wouldn't give the same khutbah in the same way. I'd talk differently. If I was talking to elders, I'd give it differently. If I was talking to students of Islam that are already knowledgeable in certain things, in certain ulum, I'd speak differently. It's not the same. And the khutbah setting is different. It's not the same as other settings. So you have to be not, the message is the same, but the way you deliver it has to be crafted and carefully constructed. Now the few minutes that I have left, وَالشُعَرَىٰ, beautiful commentary Allah says. وَالشُعَرَىٰ, and as far as the poets are concerned, you have to understand, the poets were the entertainment industry of that time. They were the movie industry. They were the song industry, the music industry. You know? Why is that? Because the Arabs didn't have flat screen TVs and Netflix, and they didn't have any of that stuff. You know, they didn't even have theaters where they would watch performing arts. They'd have a guy sitting by a bonfire, and they're all drinking away in Jahiliyyah times, and this guy's telling them a story through his poetry, and they're all sitting there imagining it happening because the Arabic language is very vivid, it's very picturesque. So they're literally watching a movie by this guy narrating it. Okay, that's how they're doing. This was their entertainment industry. They spend the entire night doing this stuff, right? And so Allah is making a comment here about that entertainer, those people. What kind of people follow them? يَتَّبِعُهُمُ الْغَاوُونَ. As far as the poets are concerned, the people who follow them, and follow them, you would almost argue, religiously. Ittiba' is used when you follow someone rigorously. Like you're obsessive, compulsive about someone. That's ittiba', it's not just normal following. That's yatba'u. Yatba'u. But the ayah says yattabi'u. This is actually the ifti'al form, which is mubalagha. It's much more powerful. So they really get obsessed with who? Who gets obsessed with them? Al-ghawun. Which is commonly in English translation offered as the lost. The lost. The word ghawa, the root letters, ghawa, ghain, waw, and ya, they actually allude to two main themes. Ibn Thabis argues this, Ibn Manzur and Lisan al-Arab argues this. They argue that it refers to al-badal, which means misguidance, and al-khayba, which actually means disappointment. So this word is two things. What kinds of people follow singers, artists, you know, songwriters, poets of that time? People that are number one, lost, and number two, suffering disappointment. Man, this is true until today. This guy, some girl dumped him, and he's like, I gotta listen to the songs, man. This guy speaks to my heart, you know what I'm saying? So he just talks to my heart when he tells me about how she left me, and I'm like, you know, I'm crying right here, and I'm missing those days that are gone back, and all that stuff, and he's lost in those emotions, right? And shu'ara even comes from mash'ar, the Arabic word mash'ar, literally, which refers to feeling. So poets are used to excite feeling. When do people download all kinds of crazy songs? The depressed people download emo music, right? Aggressive people download heavy metal. Self-absorbed people download lyrics that are about aggrandizing yourself. They take the emotions of the people, you know, and people that are suffering one kind of disappointment or another in life, and they're lost, they don't know where to turn, who's gonna counsel them? Who's gonna make them feel better? Well, let's just download some music. So you'll find people's phones, most of the hard drive is taken up by the music files. Right, and they just go from one song to another, depending on what mood they're in. Man, I'm feeling really down, I gotta listen to this, then I gotta listen to this, then I gotta listen to this. And they're just constantly, it's ringing in their head. They can't even think for themselves. As a matter of fact, they listen to music so much, and they listen to these lyrics so much, that even when they're not listening to it, it's playing in their head. It's still playing in their head. Their brains are so used to being fried, that even when they're off the deep fryer, they're still popping. You know? So they have no time to think for themselves, and that's why it's logical to understand that they're lost all the time. These addicts are lost all the time. يَتَّبِعُهُمُ الْغَاوُونَ. And then, so that's the fan base, right? This is Allah's commentary about the fans of musicians. And the word ittiba' is interesting. They're so lost, they don't know who to follow, so they become obsessed with this artist, with this singer, with this singer-songwriter, with this band. And they'll follow them on Facebook, they'll buy a poster of them from Walmart and put it up on in their room, you know. They're gonna try to dress like them. They're gonna try to send them emails even though nobody's gonna respond. They're gonna try to get tickets to their concert. They're gonna be in the first row crying as they're singing their song. This guy is shedding tears, you know. He's having an emotional experience because of the artist that's there. This stuff is crazy. But it's real. If millions of people are affected by just these brief words, this commentary of Allah isn't restricted to some historical phenomenon. This is something we see all around us, even today. You know? And they'll say, this person speaks to me. It's like he knows me. It's the funny thing. It's like he knows me. He don't know you and he don't care about you. He just cares about this. That's all he cares about. And he or she, When they make their albums and this and that, they talk about it, I would do anything for you. I would give up everything for you. I would die for you, etc., etc. What does the next ayah say about these lyrics that these people write? Allah says, "Wa annahum after alam tara annahum fi kulli wadin yahimun," which is the last commentary I'll make. "Wa annahum yaquluna ma la yaf'alun," and they say all kinds of things they'll never do. They're not going to do any of that stuff. They just say it. They just say it to excite your emotions. And you know, this is again a contrast with prophets who are trying to also amass an audience to guide them to Allah. But you know what? Prophets, they never say something they don't do. You'll see them say something and they'll live by it. It'll be in their character. وَأَنَّهُمْ يَقُولُونَ مَا يَفْعَلُونَ. That's the prophets. They say and do the same thing. There's a consistency in their message and their practice. The last bit I wanted to share with you, I shared this recently with my students as well in the class, was the process of the artist, the process of the musician, the process of the poet, whose only goal is to entertain. Allah puts their thought process and their career goals in one ayah. How they work, how that entire industry works. Allah says, أَلَمْ تَرَى أَنَّهُمْ فِي كُلِّ وَادٍ يَهِيمُونَ. Haven't you seen that these people, فِي كُلِّ وَادٍ, in every single possible valley, يَهِيمُونَ, they venture off. Let me explain what this means. It's actually a figure of speech of the Arabic language, هَامَ فِي كُلِّ وَادٍ. هَامَ is used in Arabic for a camel who's lost in the desert looking for water. And it goes this way and that way and that way, and it doesn't know where to turn. You can tell clearly this thing is lost. This is called heem in Arabic. That's the verb used for these guys. And Allah describes, they're wandering desperately in every single valley. This is an image in the Quran. Allah depicts an image of how these people work. See, the thing is, they come up with this song, and they take it, you know, they release it, and it goes platinum, and there's, you know, a million downloads or whatever, and they're winning an award. But after the awards are over, and after 2 weeks of listening to the same song, people say, man, turn that stuff off. I can't stand it anymore. Dude, I heard it too much. Put something else on. And when they do that, when they say put something else on, this poor artist, he goes through a depression, man. He's like, people don't love me anymore. All that self-worth I had built, the accolades, the, you know, the standing ovations, the applause, all of it disappeared. I gotta come up with another song. I gotta release a new album. So he starts working hard to make the next one. That's his, he goes into another valley. He starts working hard to make the next one. But the next one people don't like so much. First one was better. I didn't like the sequel. I didn't like the sequel, it was kind of garbage. So he gets even more desperate. So now he decides, and we've seen this over and over, especially in the last decade, these young, you know, Disney phenomenon, these children that were taken by this evil company and brought to the spotlight, right? And when they reached preteen years and teenage years, then they were turned into sexual icons, ma'alallah. This was done with them. These were, you know, the Miley Cyruses of the world and all these people. These were children, and they were on children's shows. Right, our Muslim girls used to have book backpacks going to Islamic school with Miley Cyrus on them. Right, this was the case. And then when they get a little older, then they say, well, that's not going to sell anymore. You can't be the icon of innocence and humor. You have to become a different kind of icon. So take some of those clothes off and release some filthy videos. And we bought our children those book bags. We bought our children those, let them download those songs or watch those shows in our homes on TV. So we made them fans of these people. So when they got to a certain age, they're going into some other valley now, because they gotta keep up. They gotta keep their audience going. أَلَمْ تَرَ أَنَّهُمْ فِي كُلِّ وَادٍ يَهِيمُونَ. They have no standards. There's not anything beneath them, basically. In order to keep their crowd, they are willing to do anything. Anything. And you see more proof of that day after day after day in the entertainment industry than you will ever need to know. You will ever need to. It's clear as day. So Allah says, أَلَمْ تَرَ أَنَّهُمْ فِي كُلِّ وَادٍ يَهِيمُونَ. SubhanAllah, the da'i to Islam, and the one who follows Allah's deen, he doesn't have to go from one valley to the next, to the next, to the next, one subject to the next, to the next, one style to the next, to the next. Allah gave us satisfaction. أَلَا بِذِكْرِ اللَّهِ تَطْمَئِنُّ الْقُلُوبِ. Right? By remembering Allah, hearts become tranquil, they become at peace. They're not at unrest, like, what else can I do? Who else? I'm not looking for anybody's attention. Because I have Allah's attention, and الَّذِي أَرَاكَ حِينَ تَقُومُ. I already have that. It's good enough for me. So I am not depressed. And I'm not desperate for a crowd. Prophets were only desperate to get the crowd for their sake, not their own sake. That's the difference, you see? That's the last thing I'll share with you. We are desperate to get the message of Islam out, not for our own sake, for the sake of the people. The entertainment wants a large crowd. The entertainer wants a large crowd, not for the people's sake, but for his own sake. It's a selfish motive. But the prophets and their work is a selfless motive. It's for others. So if nobody shows up, it makes us sad, not because we didn't get an audience, but it makes us sad that we didn't get to spread it to more people. We didn't get to give the message to more and more people, you know? It's a different way of looking at things. Now, I know I'm over my time. Just one brief comment about the final ayah, إِلَّا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَعَمِلُوا الصَّالِحَاتِ. Allah makes an exception at the end. Am I saying poetry is wrong and evil? No, I'm not. Even Allah makes the exception that istithna can go to multiple things in the ayat. It can go to وَالشُّعَرَاءُ إِلَّا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا يَتَّبِعُهُمُ الْغَاوُونَ إِلَّا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا. In other words, the poets, there are some poets who truly believe. And they do good deeds, and their poetry is fine, because they don't follow, they don't have an evil following, and what comes out of them is also something decent. And they don't venture into every valley, they don't just consider any topic, or talk about anything, just because it's going to stir up controversy, and therefore get them attention. They're not like that. On the other hand, even the fan base, the people who truly believe, and do righteous deeds, they're not going to be idiotic fans to anything. They're not going to be the ghawoon that follow just anything. They're not going to be easily impressed. The believer is impressed with truth, with reason, with purpose. So you'll find the believing community having a following of a scholar, of a da'i, of a teacher, and having tremendous respect for him. You know, those are ulama, subhanAllah, the ones that are contributing and trying to teach the community, and some of them are, you know, they're recording things. Like I'm reminded immediately of Sheikh Muhammad Ratib ibn Nabusi, who may Allah protect him, who was in Syria for some time. I think he's out now. You know, and you know the situation in Syria. I mean, the man's done like a sharh of the entire Bukhari and a tafsir of the entire Quran. And so many hundreds of thousands, if not millions of people are listening and benefiting from his work. And others, like, you know, I'm reminded of Sheikh Al-Sha'rawi rahimahullah in the past, who changed the entire culture of a country, of Egypt, and of their attitude towards the Quran. Right? These are serious people. And we are fans of those people. We're fans of them. We admire them. And we love them. And as we should. Because they are not shu'ara, they're not looking to entertain us. They're looking to bring us closer to Allah Azza wa Jal. So Allah puts the alternative on the other side. So I pray that we're able to have that kind of an affiliation with good role models, with people that actually have a beneficial message to offer for ourselves and our families. And we don't fall under the same category of sheep, mindless sheep, that so many have become, and is so evident in the things they expose themselves to on a daily basis, you know, in terms of music and entertainment. بارك الله لي ولكم في القرآن الحكيم ونفعني وإياكم بالآيات وذكر الحكيم. الحمد لله وكفى والصلاة والسلام على عباده الذين اصطفى خصوصا على أفضلهم وخاتم النبيين محمد الأمين وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. يقول الله عز وجل في كتابه الكريم بعد أن أقول أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم إن الله وملائكته يصلون على النبي يا أيها الذين آمنوا صلوا عليه وسلموا تسليما اللهم صل على محمد وعلى آل محمد كما صليت على إبراهيم وعلى آل إبراهيم في العالمين إنك حميد مجيد اللهم بارك على محمد وعلى آل محمد كما باركت على إبراهيم وعلى آل إبراهيم في العالمين إنك حميد مجيد عباد الله رحمكم الله اتقوا الله إن الله يأمر بالعدل والإحسان وإيتاء ذي القربى وينهى عن الفحشاء والمنكر ولذكر الله أكبر والله يعلم ما تصنعون. أقم الصلاة إن الصلاة كانت على المؤمنين كتابا موقوتا.